There's a big debate about who is God. In fact, if you ask 10 different people about God, you hear 10 different opinions. And it's not about whether you're right or I'm right or he's right or she's right. It doesn't matter who's right or wrong. I think what is most pressing in today's society is, have you experienced God? And what's it like to experience him? That's why in this series, Check Him Out, we're looking at three things. I would call it nothing, something, everything. Did you hear me? Nothing, something, everything. So I could tell you something that at first it looks like nothing, but really it is something that has everything to do with your future, with your happiness, with your stability, with who you are, with how you perceive the world and make a difference. We're going to talk about God. Instead of talking in a debate format, you're right, I'm right, I want you to check them out for yourself. Experience God. Check him out.
Welcome to the Check Him Out series with Jose Rojas. We are here at the Lane County Fairgrounds in Eugene, Oregon. And my name is David McCoy, and I'm one of the area pastors here locally in Eugene, Oregon. In a few moments, we'll hear from Jose Rojas. But first, we're going to hear from Vonda Bierman, who is a very dear friend. She's a Three Angel Award winner. She travels all over the world singing about the love of Jesus, and she does that with Quiet Hour Television Ministry. And especially, she wants you to know that all that she does to the glory of God, and she does that through her many talents with song and music.
Jesus. Oh, how I want to walk with Jesus in the blue.
Jesus,
how I want to walk with Jesus in that land.
Shabbat Shalom. There is singing up in heaven, such as we have never known, where the angels sing the praises of the Lamb upon the throne. Yes, their harps are ever tuneful, their voice is always clear. Oh, that we might be more like them as we serve the Master here. Holy, holy. That's what the angels sing, and I expect to help them make the courts of heaven ring. But when I sing redemption story, the angels will fold their wings, for angels never felt the joys that our salvation brings. Wait, wait, I hear another anthem, blending voices clear and strong. Unto him who has redeemed us and has bought us is that song. Oh, we've come through many trials, battles fought, victories won. Oh, for him who has saved us and has said to us, well done, holy. Holy, that's what the angels sing. And I expect to help them make the courts of heaven ring. But when I sing redemption story, the angels will fold their wings. For angels never felt the joys that our salvation brings. Let's pray together. Our Father, our God, bless your people once again. Pour out your Holy Spirit among us now. For, sir, yet once again, we would see Jesus. In his name we ask. Amen. Today's word is taken from the prophet Micah. Micah chapter 6 and verse 8. Micah chapter 6, verse 8. While everyone scrambles feverishly to find it, those of you watching at home, Micah is near the end of the Old Testament. I'll stall a little bit and I'll give you a chance to find it. Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk. So Mike is right in there. Micah chapter 6 and verse 8. He has shown thee, O man, what is good and what it is that the Lord requires of you. See, if you really want to know what God wants you to do, if you want to know what God wants you to do, you look at Micah chapter 6 and verse 8. He has shown thee, O man, what is good, and what doth the Lord require of you? It's three things right here. Do justice, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. What are the three things? Do justice, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. Now, this prophet has written many things. But this verse is the one that jumps out that most people have learned. God asked us only three things. Because see, the Ten Commandments, the first four are the description of a relationship and love to God. The last six commandments are a description of a relationship and love for people made in the image of God. If you walk with Jesus Christ as your Lord, your Savior, your Messiah, you will understand what the Ten Commandments are. If you do not walk with the Lord, Paul was very careful to point out, the Ten Commandments to you become a problem and a pain and a list of rules and a reason to judge everybody else for not keeping them, even though you yourself don't keep them either. See, the absence of Jesus means chaos. But when Jesus becomes your Messiah, your Savior, the Ten Commandments become cool. Because kind of like, you know, like, they're cool. See, now for me to live is Jesus, and to die I count as gain. I used to think that was just a heroic statement by the apostles, but it is true. I have faced death many times, and I realize now I'm not afraid to die for Jesus anymore. For me to live is Jesus, and if I die, I count it an honor to die for the Messiah. Other people are so afraid of dying, they whip themselves into a frenzy about times of trouble and persecution and death penalties. We don't need a Friday the 13th when you have your Sabbath the 13th to go to. We were told clearly it was a message of deliverance, yet we have made it a message of woe. Those who do not have a Messiah, those who do not have Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, are so worried about dying, they forgot what living in Jesus can be. He has shown you what is good and what the Lord requires of you. It's just three things. One, do justice. Two, love mercy. Three, walk humbly with your God. You know, if you let humans do justice, you know what kind of justice we want, right? Yeah, man. Lock them up, man. A member of my family was arrested stealing a $5 flashlight. A $5 flashlight. But in that state, they put the three strikes and you're outlaw into place. It was his second strike. He was facing 5 years in prison for taking a $5 flashlight. I felt bad because I had gone to see him the week before. I dropped in, and he was so excited to see me. He says, I want to give you some. And he grabbed his precious flashlight, a police flashlight, one of those big metal ones. He said, I want you to have it. I said, dude, you need it for you. No, no, I love you, man. Here, take this flashlight. Well, after I took his precious flashlight, he now needed one. So he went and took one. But it was his second strike. It was difficult to work it out in the legal system because people think that justice means punish human beings badly, and the more and the worse you can punish them. In fact, if we could just kill them all. There are people who argue vehemently for death penalties. You know why? Because they don't have anybody in prison. They don't know what it's like to have a convict in the family, or two, or three, or 10 convicts. They don't know that they're human beings made in the image of God. Now, I'm not saying that there is no consequence for breaking the law. If I drive 75 miles an hour down Jefferson Street, I deserve to get pulled over. And maybe even have my license suspended. I'm happy to report I did 32 miles per hour, in case anybody was curious that this was a confession in public. You break the law, pay your debt to society. I'm not talking about law and order. I'm not talking about crime and punishment. I'm talking about the attitude of the citizens who claim Jesus with their mouth, but their hearts are far from it. And you want another human being to die. Well, what about the victims of crime? Death penalty. You know what? I am the victim of a crime. People murdered my brother. I met the murderers who are proud of themselves and will never apologize for what they did. I don't want them dead. I want them saved. They took something precious from me. No, I'm not a bleeding heart liberal. I'm a son of Jesus Christ. I'm not a good person, but I hang out with a good God. He's taught me to love my enemies, to do good to them who despitefully use me, to pray for those who mess with me, and not defend myself. You'll discover when you write hate mail to me or tell me off that I'll thank you, hug you, and ask you to pray with me. Who am I to think I'm above reproach? There are often times I go home bleeding emotionally from the mistreatments of others, but I don't hate you. I ask you not to hate me. During the riots in L.A., as the city was burning down because of this young man who had been beaten by L.A. police, and the police officers, although there was this long videotape, were found innocent. Those of us who have families that have been beaten up by cops said, finally, we have it on tape. The anger was palpable. And when Rodney King, the object of everyone's anger, came out on camera that afternoon and said, can't we all just get along? One of the most eloquent statements I've ever heard. Haven't heard stuff like that in years, not even from a politician. When the object of everybody's anger, the guy that was beaten up, comes out and says, can't we all just get along? I went back to my Bible. Do justice. Don't do justice as we would have it done, because we'll hurt each other. I'm going to take this to the church board. Amen. I love you. That's why I'm going to have you kicked out. It's amazing the kinds of things we do. Roughing up our pastors as if God gave us permission to interrupt the ministry of His anointed. Woe be to him or her who interferes in God's work. Even if you hold a Bible in your hand, you have been given no divine permission to interfere with the rabbi. He's just a human being. He makes mistakes. But don't you dare interrupt in what God is planning to do. He's called us to do justice. And if you want an example of the justice of God, just look at what Yeshua did when Jesus walked on this planet. He healed 10 lepers, all of whom said, please heal us. He healed all 10 of them. Only one came to thank him. Where are the other 9 guys? Well, they're pretty happy. They laughed. But I just wanted to thank you. I've been sick for 3 years. Thank you. You're welcome. He's thinking about the other 9, but he's proud of this one. His justice isn't to get even with anybody. How did Jesus treat the people who wanted to kill him? He always prayed for them, even when he was dying on the cross. Forgive them. They know not what they do. His example of justice was never to give people what they deserved. Think of this, because we think justice is you deserve it, you should have it. Jesus never gave people what they deserved. He gave them what they needed. You were born blind, he'd open your eyes. You were paralyzed, he'd raise you up. You had died, you'd get up again. If there was a storm, he calmed it. If you were hungry, he gave you to eat. He'd give you his own tunic to keep warm. No matter what, if your feet were dirty, he would not wait for the servant, which was a tradition and the requirement. He himself would put his tunic as a towel, wash your dirty feet, and wipe them. He had footprints all over his tunic, and it smelled weird when he put it back on. To lead that famous Passover supper with his disciples, he didn't smell well anymore. Because he did justice that night. While the guys were waiting for a servant to show up and wash the feet. No, Jesus did the justice. He didn't give them what they deserved. He gave them what they needed. Do justice. That's what the Lord requires of you. Do justice. And he told them, love the unlovely. Love those who persecute you falsely in my name. Do good to those who abuse you. Pray for those who despise. When's the last time you prayed for those who were messing with you? Lord, thank you. They really hurt my feelings. Thank you for keeping me humble. Bless them. That's my prayer all the time. This is quite a, I'm back. It was pretty rough. Thank you, Lord. I don't know why you allow it. It really hurts. But bless them wherever they are. I know they mean well. Those who cannot see often think they can. And they mistreat you. Sometimes with a Bible or prophetic writings in their hands. But I've been told by Jesus to do justice, to love people who brutalize me. And then the conscience of those who do those things must be awakened. Repent of your sin and cease and desist from hurting innocent people. Instead of hurting them, help them. The other night I told you that I was asked to preach in the church where my brother was kicked out for his appearance, for how he was dressed, for being a gang member on the streets. Everybody knew who he was. They were afraid of his influence on their young people. He was escorted out of the church, and he died just 1 mile down the street from that church, begging for his life. I stood in the very place where my poor brother was kicked out, and they wanted me to be happy. Of course, they weren't aware that I was the brother. But praise the Lord, a ministry of reconciliation occurred that day as we forgave each other. You follow what I'm saying? Doing justice doesn't mean you give people what they deserve. You give them what they need. And if people have messed up, now they need love more than ever before. Not an excuse, not an acceptance of sin, but they need to be accepted. They need to be loved. Teenagers act up. Anybody here a parent of a teenager? Oh, I once was 70 years ago, and I still remember it. When a teenager's hurting, any professional will tell you, they act up. What does a teenager acting up do? Oh, and they have cell phones and computers to back them up. Very sophisticated, because this is a kid with an attitude problem. Imagine the same young person with the attitude of Christ. What will happen? We've seen what the devil can do with a frustrated young person. Imagine what the Holy Spirit can do. Don't give a young person what they deserve. Give them what they need. They need a mentor. They don't need our condemnation. They need us to take them under our wings, that they too may learn to fly. It's time, church, do justice. But you know, you want to know how to do justice? You want to know how what the step is to learn how to do justice? Number two tells you. What is it? Do justice, love mercy. Remember when you were little, just not that long ago, and you'd be arguing with your siblings, and mom would break it. Well, what happened? She started it. Remember that? He started it. And your mom would always say what? It doesn't matter who started, she started it. How can you be hitting your sister and you're 12 and she's 4? It's because she started and you're still crying. The 4-year-old still beat you up. She started it. As if starting it gives you permission to brutalize a member of your family. You see what I'm saying? But as adults, we do the same thing. Well, she started it. She knows what she did. We haven't talked in 7 years, but she knows what she did. Forgive the unforgivable. You know how you do it? You learn mercy. Okay, now apologize to your sister. But she started. Apologize to your sister, or back then, now it's the child abuse and you get turned into child protective services. But a leather belt at my family was a very persuasive instrument. It was never used. It was just... apologize to her. Sorry. Apologize to her for real. Sorry. I already apologized twice. Sorry. Okay, go to your room. You're grounded. Were you really sorry? No, you were hopeful you wouldn't get that belt. That's not sorry. You weren't really sorry. And your sister, he's not sorry. He's 12 and I'm 4. That's not right. You see? And so you think that mercy at the tip of a belt was the way to do it. No, 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 no. You learn to love mercy. What is mercy? Have you ever had that ticket? Don't raise your hand, just your conscience. You were caught doing that 75 in a 55 zone going up Highway 5 toward Portland? Or after you crossed the bridge coming in from Vancouver? Okay. or when you were going through the Cascades in a 20 zone? How did you do it without rolling the truck? But the highway patrol clocked you, and you went before the judge. All right, you were doing 75 in a 55 zone. You were zigzagging through traffic, reckless driving. You caused two other cars to slam their brakes, which could have caused an accident. What do you plead? If you say innocent, it's going to be a bad day for you. I'm guilty, Your Honor. And there's a lot of other people who just got sentenced, got their license revoked, $500 fines before. You remember the carnage before it was your turn? And now it's your turn, and others are watching you face the music. And the judge says, well, I could fine you the $380 and send you to driving school. But since this is your first violation, the court will extend mercy. You go to this class two nights a week for the next 3 weeks. We'll even clear your record as if it never happened. Thank you. Thank you. It's okay. Just get out of my court before I change my mind. What was it like to have mercy? To get not what you deserve, but what you needed? Because you know you didn't have the $378. I mean, the electric bill's due, the water bill's due, the rent is due, and the kids said they were hungry sometime yesterday. And you don't have this money to give to the court, right? You need every penny at the house. And the judge says, this time the court will extend mercy. You see, those who've experienced mercy are the ones who know how to give it away. If you still carry the guilt of your sins, no wonder you don't understand how to give love to somebody else. I have good news for you. It doesn't matter what you've done, what you have failed to do in life. If you repent, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful. He is just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from how much? All unrighteousness, as far as the east is from the west. That's how far God will separate your rebellion. As deep as the ocean is, are you aware that the Pacific Ocean in the trench is deeper than Mount Everest is high? That's pretty deep. And if God is separating our rebellions that far, when God forgives us, we've experienced mercy. We got not what we deserve, but what we needed. The justice of God is to save His people from their sins, not to kill them. Yet others love to preach hellfire, and the Lord has got to cook you, and you're got to feel every flame down to your toenail. That is not God. He's faithful in telling us how He's going to finish sin off, how He's going to cleanse this planet. But it's also known as the strange act of God, that He should go beyond Himself to clean and forever wipe the whole thing of sin away from us. But those who want to live forever, you can begin by experiencing His mercy right now. And those who truly have been forgiven by God now know how to forgive someone else. If you've never truly experienced grace, no wonder you struggle giving grace away. If you don't know what it looks like, how do you know how to give it away? But if you've experienced it, how did it feel to receive mercy when you needed it most? Now, as you have freely received, freely give. It's a lot of fun. My mother always taught me, if you're going to give something away, give away your best. Do you give away your best? Well, it's been sitting back there for 30 years. I better get rid of it. Hey, do you want that old? You could have it. My mother says, you're going to give something away, give your best. I collect rocks and minerals. I had crystals, Brazilian amethysts. I had citron quartz, I had chalcedonies, I had gold veins in feldspar, I had silver crystals, and every time a little kid, I want to
Learn to collect rocks.
Here, son. Take this crystal. Forget about the fact that it cost $890. Take the crystal, son. You're giving this to my boy. He said he wants to learn how to collect rocks and minerals. He may as well start at the top. And I gave away all my rocks. I didn't realize it, so... And now I had a bunch of kids of my own, so I couldn't afford to go buy them again. The things we do when we're single radically change after marriage. So I started buying crystals. Not crystals. Crystals. Not veins of gold, but a gold flake. Oh, look it, look it. Watch, get the microscope. There it is. There it is. I found it. Don't tell me you collect rocks and minerals, because I'll give it to you. I always give away my most precious stuff. If you're going to give something away, give away your best. So don't tell me you like my Toyota. I'll be walking to work. It's a 72, but it runs. I'm just kidding. And so you see, mercy, you learn to love mercy. Not, well, she's incredible. Yes, I have an obligation to love her, even though I hate her guts. So, I love you. I really don't, but I love you. I'm not telling the truth, but I love you. See, doesn't that feel like the kid? Okay, sorry. Sorry. What a difference when someone who deserves nothing from you, some miserable person who broke your heart, and you're able to say, you know what, you really hurt me, but I love you and I forgive you. That's power. If you want to know how it feels, go try it at home. Forgive that spouse of yours. No, leave me alone. You know what you did. But sweetheart, that was 48 years ago. I don't want to talk about it. Maybe it's time to let it go. Experience mercy at your house. Mission begins at home. Begin to experience it now. Forgive that terrible thing that happened all those decades ago. I know you can, because if you've received God's mercy, you can give mercy to your spouse, to your loved one, to your cousin, to your sister, to your brother, to your neighbor, to that one guy at work, that boss. Love mercy. If you learn to love mercy, you'll be doing God's justice all day long. Now, I know what you're thinking. How do I learn to love mercy? Well, that's the third step that tells you how to learn to love mercy. So as you do justice, you love mercy. What is the third one? Walk humbly with your God. Do you walk humbly with your God, or do you go to church once a week? There's a big difference, you know. There are people who go to church once a week who have never met God. They just kind of go because you're supposed to. Well, this is what we do. I mean, what else am I going to do? So I go. Walk with your God. Gentlemen, remember when you started dating her? Remember that first time you took her for a walk? What did your mom say? Ah, no walks into the woods. You will walk where I can see you. Remember that? My mom did that. All right. I'm 19. I mean, what's up with my mom? My mom knows everything. Isn't it true, Mom? Stay where I can see. We walked 10 miles, but she could see the two dots in the distance. Too many trees in these beautiful mountains. Remember when you took her for a walk? To walk together is exciting stuff. When I travel, sooner or later, one of my colleagues, I say, let's go for a walk. At the office, I work at the General Conference, where when I have to talk something really deep, I say, walk with me. And you'll see us doing laps around the building Because when you walk, you're oxygenating your brain. You're improving your thought process, your neural function. Frontal lobe reasoning kicks in. Your alpha waves now begin to integrate with beta waves. Your temporal lobes kick in. Suddenly, short-term and long-term memory participate in a discussion. And all of a sudden, analysis, review, composition of ideas, and suddenly ministry concepts rise to the surface, all because you went on a walk. Ooh, it's pretty exciting stuff. Did you take notes on that? There will be a quiz on Monday. I'm just kidding. You'll be safely home on Monday. Going for a walk is a powerful thing. If you walk humbly with your God, here's how you walk humbly. You read what He has taught, and then you believe it. I'm not saying accept it, because I accept God's word. Do you? Do you accept His teachings? Do you accept truth? Yes. But do you believe it? You want to know how you believe something? It's when you do it. You can accept something without ever believing it. If you believe in your marriage, you do things that demonstrate you believe in it. Otherwise, you just accept it. Well, we're married, so we're married. It's just the way it is. Take her hand in the darkness. Nobody will notice. Believe in your home again. Have love be reborn in your house. It's not impossible. Since God brought you together, God can bless you again. And I'm not just talking to you young ones either. I had an elderly woman tell me recently, I recognize I don't love him anymore. He doesn't love me, but 62 years, what else are we going to do? We need each other. You can fall in love again. The same thing happens with God. You can fall in love again. There are people who once walked with Him, but you stopped walking long ago. You've just been sitting there knowing all these things and wondering what it's all going to come to. After all of this knowledge, I'm sitting here, and it's going to come to a time of trouble and sadness and suffering and persecution and death. No wonder you're not walking anymore. Get up and start walking with the Lord. Believe what His prophets have said. Live the Word of God. For you to live can be Jesus. Don't just think Him. Do Him in your life. And the way you do it is by going out there. Living Him to such a point that you become contagious. Have you had the flu? Flu season's coming back, you know. They call it the H1N1, otherwise known as the oink, oink, swine flu. The thing about H1N1 is that none of us are immune to it, so guaranteed we're going to get it. Okay, guaranteed if we're exposed to it and the incubation pays off. Okay, so if you're exposed and it incubates in your body, guaranteed there's no way out of it, you're going to get it. Well, what you haven't seen yet is that when it first came in the first wave last year, only 128 people died nationally in the United States of America. Forget about the 38,000 who died of the regular flu. Everybody's scared about the 128 who passed. H1N1 ended up being no big deal. Now, as it combines with the other one and is guaranteed that you're exposed to it, guess how you stay ahead of it? What do you do if you're exposed to the flu? Something as simple as washing your hands. Do you wash your hands? Wash them more often. You go to church, you just shook hands with 100 people. What do you do? Excuse me, I'm going to wash my hands. Because I have the virus here and I do this. What have I just done? I put it right here to be absorbed into the soft tissues of my sinuses so that the virus makes it into my bloodstream. And then as my body is unable to fend it off, within an incubation period of 36 hours, suddenly symptomology breaks out. I have a funny taste in my mouth, and and a sore throat. And what do you do when you experience that? Drink lots of water, stay in bed, and don't go infect anyone else. Don't come shake hands with me. I'm just kidding. Some people, Pastor. And I still, oh well, I'm going to be sick this week. And then after a bit, excuse me, when I still go wash my hands, just in case I get away with it. You see, walking has inherent risks. But you know what? It's been many years since I've had the flu. Maybe now that I've said that publicly, I'll probably get the flu this year. That'll be my stay humble thing for the year. You see, the Lord wants us to walk with Him and to love others. Humility is a good thing. I'm going to share with you a secret I live by, and I want to challenge you to do the same. It has been many years since I've defended myself. Only in the court of law do you need defense and get a good lawyer. But out here, accuse me of anything and I will not defend myself. You can ask clarifying questions, but if you accuse me of this or accuse me of that, I'll just absorb it and ask you to pray for me. Because I found that defending myself can make me angry, and then suddenly I'm angry at you, and then suddenly the humility is broken. What if you're right and I need the counsel? So by not defending myself, when the counsel is appropriate, I absorb it and say, thank you, Lord, you sent someone to give me counsel. And when the counsel, 99.99999% of the time, is wrong, and they just brutalize me with a Bible in their hand, send the Bible verses, since you don't seem to read. And then they pray for you. And I will not defend myself, because that's how God keeps me broken. He keeps me humble. I never have energy to be proud, because I'm always broken from the last stuff that happened. And so walking humbly with my God is very real. He keeps me humble the hard way. People do it to me. See, walking humbly with my God has taught me about His mercy. That's why I've learned more and more each day, and I invite you to learn more and more each day how to love mercy. And so as you learn to love mercy more and more each day, we will do God's justice. The character of Christ will be perfectly revealed in His people. We will do what He does. We will love as He loves. We will be faithful unto death as He is faithful unto death. You can actually come to the day that you can say, so what if times of trouble come? The Lord and I are together on this. If I should die, so be it. As long as I die in Jesus, I'm not even worried about it. The times that people have shot at me, those of you who've worn uniforms maybe, and those of you who've been out here, I noticed, I won't name the streets I've noticed, because I read graffiti. Stuff happens in Eugene. I could tell. And kids always put the stories on the walls. You just have to read what's going on out here. Did you know that? You live here. Did you know? Or did you get it from the newspaper? I'm telling you right now, when people shoot at you, the sound is, and when something lands around you, ping, ping, little puff of dust coming off the pavement, and boo, boo. And then, of course, with the adrenaline rush, you can win a gold medal in the Olympics at that moment. Never run in a straight line, because that gives them plenty of opportunity to aim. Run in a zigzag. And because they're busy looking cool, holding the gun sideways, they can't shoot straight. And I'm not going to teach them how to shoot straight, you know? We will just leave that as is. And the Lord in His mercy has kept me humble yet another day. And I've learned to love the unlovely yet another level. And I learned to pray for those who despitefully use me in actual terms, not in theoretical or theological suppositions of something that has yet to occur. Now you wear a uniform and come after me. Been there, done that. For me to live is Jesus, and to die I count as gain. American soldiers right now in Iraq and Afghanistan report that this enemy is difficult to fight against. How do you fight against an enemy that considers it an honor to die? Because when they're shooting at us, we don't want to die. We duck for cover. They rarely duck for cover. They keep coming at you. That's what makes an enemy difficult. If the devil faces an army of people who believe in the Messiah, who are unafraid to die, filled with the Holy Spirit, that is what has been prophesied. Do justice, because you love mercy. And you learned that from walking humbly with your God. What a simple recipe for what God's people do in these last days. I have good news for you. Jesus, John 14, has gone to prepare a place for you. And if he's gone to prepare a place for you, it's because he's coming back. You thought his first coming was great, born in a barn with angels singing out there to shepherds. Try a trillion shofars, the trumpet of the Lord blasting as waves across the planet. Such trillions of an innumerable company of angels that they look like a cloud. And he's sitting upon a throne with a crown upon a crown upon a crown. And he has come to harvest the planet. He's holding a sickle in his hand. And then he tells the sheep, I was hungry, you fed me. I was naked, and you took your own clothes, and you covered me with dignity. I was sick, and you came to see me. I was in prison. You came to visit me. I was a stranger, and you took me into your house. And the saved will say, when did we do that? When you were in Eugene. And you did it to the least of these, my people. When you gave people things not that they deserved, but what they needed. When you loved mercy. When you walked humbly. And you made it happen in the Eugene. Throughout the whole region, the metro area, throughout the valley, in every village and town, across every property and farm. You did it to me. Serving God means you are serving people also made in his image. Doesn't mean you sit at home and read your Bible and go to church once a week. It means you get out there and love somebody who's dying. You know, the Ducks are coming to town tomorrow. And Eugene will be the largest city in Oregon tomorrow. 70,000 strong. They're selling the last tickets at $25 each for standing room only tickets. That means you're going to stand there for 8 hours. I want to sit down, but I got to see the game. My legs are falling off, but I don't care, man. It's the third quarter, man. The Ducks are in town. Macy's is selling Duck shirts like crazy. People are only going to wear it one day, but they'll pay $80 for the T-shirt. The Ducks are coming to town, and folks are excited. I got good news for you. Jesus is coming to town. I don't know how many T-shirts are being sold. I don't know how many standing room only tickets are being handed out for free, but the only way for people to know that Jesus is coming to town is if you tell them. Many will never know who Jesus is until you show up and they see him in you. I want to remind you that the greatest reason for atheism on planet Earth, the greatest reason why University of Oregon students doubt God, is Christians. People who claim God with their mouth, but their hearts and lives are far from him. It is time that people see Jesus in us. Is he your Messiah? Is he your Savior? Well, I hope to be found worthy. You're never going to be worthy. Is he your Savior, who even though you're unworthy, will show you mercy and forgive you of your sins and cleanse you of unrighteousness, and you will reflect his character and go home? Is he your Savior? Is Yeshua the Messiah in your life? If you have doubts, no wonder you have struggled. Well, I'm not sure anymore. If you lose sight of the Messiah, what hope do you have left? He wants to save you. What more must he do? Do justice. love mercy, walk humbly with your God. As I sing this song, has God called you to baptism? Has the Lord said to you, this is it, this is time? You know in the depths of your heart, it's time. As I play this song, I want to encourage you to join me right here so we can pray together at the end of this program. And there's another person who's sitting here tonight or who's watching from your home or from a sanctuary over the internet. Some of you are not even in the continental North America. It's time to come back. You once walked with Him, but for some reason you walked away. It is time to walk with the Lord again. So as I sing this song, come forward. Don't worry. Just come forward. I'm not calling you. It is just my joy as a minister of the gospel to share with you, God is calling you. When Jesus went back to heaven, the disciples panicked. What are we going to do, Lord? Because you're the one who does all these wonderful things. And Jesus says, everything you've seen me do, you shall be able to do, and in greater measure. In my name you will cast out demons. In my name you will heal the sick. In my name you will preach. In my name you will testify to kings and rulers and governors. And in my name you will take the gospel to the Gentiles. In my name you will do all these things. So the hands of Jesus, where are they now? We are His hands. We are His hands. People will know who Jesus is because we showed up. I wrote this song back in 1995 when I thought about that. Jesus, the greatest preacher that ever lived, was not known for His mouth. He was known for His hands. Let your life be the same. Do not be known for your mouth. Be known for what you do here in the Eugene area, throughout this valley, what you do for others. Does that make sense? Those of you who wandered in from other places, don't think you got out of it. Those of you who come from Portland north, Medford to the south, Bend to the east, you can run, but you can't hide. The Cascades are beautiful, but the same Holy Spirit falls over there. It's time, don't you think, church? As I sing this song, come forward because God is calling you. Hands across the world, hands across the world. He touches hearts with His hands across the world. Hands across the world, hands across the world. We are His hands, we're His hands across the world. He touched a man that had been blind, enabled him to see. He touched the food and passed it out for everyone to eat. He touched a leper on the street, restored him back to health. He touched a girl that had been dead, brought her back to life. Hands across the world, hands across the world. He touches hearts with His hands across the world. Hands across the world, hands across the world. We are His hands, we're His hands across the world. He touched the hearts of people, forgave them of their sins. He called to them to take their cross and then to follow Him. He touched so many people that enemies arose. They took His hands and nailed them down upon a painful cross. Hands across the world,
hands across the world. He touches hearts with his hands across the world. Hands across the world. Oh, hands across the world. We are his hands, we're his hands across the world. He's called on us, his people, to give to him our hands, to feed the hungry, clothe the poor, to tell them of his love. So let us all together give to him our hands, that others may know Jesus all around the world. Hands across the world, hands across the world. He touches hearts with his hands across the world. Hands across the world, hands across the world. We are his hands, we're his hands across the world. We're his hands, we're his hands across the world. Hands across the world, we are his hands. God bless you, each one who has come forward. God bless you. Tonight you know there is a Christ in heaven. There is a Jesus who wants to be your Messiah. You once walked with him, and for some reason you walked away. And tonight you've been convicted by his Holy Spirit, and you know that you can come back. Come on up here. Come on up, because Jesus is calling. Grab your phone book right now. Do a Google and do Seventh-day Adventist, the town where you live, and talk to the pastor and tell him that you made a decision that you want to walk with Jesus Christ. You want to study the Word of God. Is there anyone else as we conclude this program? I can't possibly conclude knowing that there's someone who's struggling at your seat. You know the Lord is calling you. Conquer your fear at this moment and just come forward. Not because you are good, but because God is good. And he's calling you. Just come on up. We will not judge you. Brothers and sisters, you must tell others what you have seen. You must tell others only what you have seen. That's what God's witnesses do. They experience the power of God. Then they tell others only what you have seen this day. Go in peace.